Thank you very much. Honorable Cabinet and Provincial Ministers,
Secretary to the Cabinet, Deputy Secretaries to the Cabinet, Clerk of the National Assembly, Permanent Secretaries, and other senior government officials that are present here, members of the press, ladies and gentlemen. I am delighted to be here to officially open this induction program for cabinet and provincial ministers. Before I go further, just to reiterate our congratulations to you for being appointed into your respective roles, roles to serve the people, not to save ourselves. So, this program today is very important. It is intended to familiarize yourselves as ministers, cabinet, as provincial ministers, with government procedures, processes, and practices, as has already been indicated by the Secretary to the Cabinet. This induction should enhance your effectiveness as officials charged with the responsibility of providing policy and strategic direction in your respective ministries and indeed provinces. The induction will also strengthen our collective responsibility and, of course, accountability. You can't have responsibilities without accountabilities. It's two sides of the same coin. So, collective responsibility and accountability in the management of public resources, public affairs, for improved service delivery to our people. This induction program will therefore lay the foundation for enhancing your performance as public officers. People occupying Zambian people's offices, please remember, as you walk in that office every day, you are occupying an office that belongs to the people of Zambia, not to yourself. I've been observing over years how many ministers in previous governments, even their style of walking, you can see that this one thinks that is his office. That office belongs to the people. As I said, State House, undergrounds, everything belongs to the people. And I'm very conscious of that every single day I walk in there, that this is for the people of Zambia. I believe you can take a leaf from there. This induction program, indeed, will assist you with that consciousness in mind to work for the people all the time. Honorable ministers, ladies and gentlemen, cabinet, as the highest policy-making organ in our country, operates on principles of collective responsibility. In other countries, they term it a collective. They call themselves, we are a collective. And I think that is true. Cabinet requires us to be confidential at all times. It requires us to declare interest where that is required. If it's not a standing declaration of interest, where a particular activity transaction requires us to disclose our interest, we should do so without being motivated, without being reminded. It's very important. As the new Dawn administration, Freedom Day administration, as people will tell you in the streets, that this is freedom. Yet again, we are bound by the policies, decisions, and programs that we shall make collectively. It is therefore expected of all of us, all of you, ministers, provincial ministers, to work in unison as a team towards the realization of our developmental goals for the good of the people of our great country, Zambia. It is imperative that as people charged with the responsibility for policy and strategic direction of the various sectors, you ensure that policies are coherent, are consistent with the overall government policy. That clarity is inevitable, otherwise you'll find it difficult to operate in your offices. The Zambian people have given us this mandate to deliver on their expectations. The confidence that the Zambian people have in our administration must be met with hard work. Hard work. Hard work. Determination. Commitment to service. Many of you know why I'm saying hard work three times. We're not on holiday. We're here to work. The two are different, distinct, distinctly different. The new Dawn administration must not only meet the people's expectations, we must exceed those expectations. Walk around in the streets of Lusaka, elsewhere, listen to what people are saying. We are free again. We expect this freedom to lead us into more entrepreneurial ways of doing things, so we can exceed our expectations of the people, the expectations of the people. Remember, we were voted in office on the premise of turning around the economy, number one. Now I can reveal to ourselves, because the competition is over for now, we won the election. We did a lot of work, scientific work, to establish what the people wanted in the 2021 elections. And top on the agenda was to turn around the economy. Science told us that. When others were giving opinion polls which were baseless, we knew where we stood. And we understood what the people wanted. The economy. Turning around the economy. Why turning around the economy? It's the people's expectations. So we can improve service delivery. So we can take services closer to the people. Decentralization. So we can lower the cost of living. Embedded in their desire to see an economic turnaround, they wanted to see a reduced cost of living. Us who are farmers, go to the main farming shop in Lusaka, you will see the prices of veterinary medicines have come down. Take a walk, very near from here. That's part of our agenda, to lower the cost of living, to lower the cost of inputs. Job creation, to create jobs for our people. Creating business opportunities for our people. Not for some people, for all our people. Of course, social support. which can only come out of a functioning economy. We need to get our order right, ministers and provincial ministers, cabinet ministers and provincial ministers. You cannot offer social support to the needy, to the sick, to the weak, to the orphans, to the retirees, without a functioning economy. Let's get that right. Because only the fruit of a successful economy will allow us to support the social sectors. I wanted to make that very clear from day one. Even if your heart is good, which is true for all of us, you cannot share poverty. You cannot redistribute nothing. You can only help those who need help if you've created something. This is what the people of Zambia voted for us to do, to turn around the economy. Then we can have medicines in hospitals. I'm harping on this so we get our thought processes clear in our ministries and as a team and as cabinet and as provinces. What are you doing out there in your area, in your ministry, to lower the cost, as Secretary of the Cabinet has said, to lower the cost of any contracts so the savings from there can go into economic growth, job creation? What are you doing? I'm departing a little bit from my text so I can say what my heart feels, maybe to help somebody here. You can't sit in a ministry or a minister. Yes, you don't do procurement. But you cannot sit there. The procurement officer is procuring a pen that costs 2 kwacha and they are procuring it at 20 kwacha. You've taken away an opportunity for a child to be in school. You cannot, my dear colleagues, under the CDF fund or any public expenditure, where as a simple farmer myself, I sink a 60 meter borehole, cast to 60 meters at 20,000 kwacha. And you in your ministry, in your province, you are allowing boreholes for our women to walk shorter distances to water sources at 60,000 kwacha per borehole. Do we live in a different country? That's what I was seeing in the last government. And we are determined, you should be determined, not to allow those issues to happen. Secretary of Cabinet, that applies to you in the public service. You cannot say because the minister is not a procuring, how shall I put it? Entity. It is me, the PS, I will buy boreholes at 60,000 kwacha. What you will have done is to take away 2 boreholes from another village that needed water. That too will not happen under this government. I think this departure sends a clear message. There will be no tolerance, zero tolerance levels to such transgressions. Why? Because the people voted for us to give them water. And we've taken water away from them. Then you walk in the morning, you sit in the chair as your minister, and say, oh, I'm doing very well. No, sir. No, madam. No. Not at all. They save money. The savings will place them in youth opportunities, empowerment opportunities, so they can employ themselves. We have to change procurement procedures, and we shall do it very quickly. Go in your ministries, check what is going wrong. I've been doing that from the day we were declared winners. I have been doing that. Long hours, I'm checking here, I'm checking there. Ask the Secretary of the Cabinet. We're talking. The savings we generate from this behavior, good behavior, will begin to make us decent people who can be proud and should be proud of the Zambians. If you say the previous government was not doing well, the very day you are appointed into your portfolio, you are making calls as to which tenders are of interest to you. Yes, you must have interest to lower the cost. Three principles. Procure at the right cost, competitive cost, benchmarked, good quality. Roads that were done and we're told roads are being done, they are peeling off already, but done at a huge cost. Not in this government, not in this New Dawn government. So, the right quality, number two, number three, I'm repeating, delivery on time. We don't have time. 5 years is not a long time. It's a very short time. There are benchmarks upon which the effectiveness of our government will be measured in the next 5 years, as mandated by the people of Zambia. Ministers, cabinet ministers, provincial ministers, I will not hesitate to make necessary administrative changes for us to remain on course and achieve our objectives. We will not be shy to do that. You are a cabinet that reflects the face of Zambia. But that does not justify you transgressing against the people's will because you come from a region which is supposed to be also on cabinet. Yes, there are many people from your region that can also be cabinet ministers. I think that's fair, in my view. Honorable ministers, ladies and gentlemen, the presentations that are lined up in today's induction highlight some of the signposts to warn you about the dangers of not adhering to procedures, processes and practices in the execution of your duties. We must acquaint ourselves with the aforementioned factors because failure to do so may result in the intolerable breach of the rule of law, which we have undertaken to respect. I believe ignorance, even at law, is no defense. So this workshop should help us. I'm convinced that at the end of this induction, you'll have better understanding of how government business is conducted. We discuss with the Secretary of Cabinet out there that this will not be the first in the exercise of this nature. We plan to do it quarterly. Why? We can alumni with each other. We can compare notes. How has it been in the last 3 months? And you yourselves will be making suggestions that what you found in your ministries are these challenges that we can help each other to resolve. And that will help us build a team, collective, for the service of our people. I guess we agreed. And I'm reminded that this such has not happened before. Am I right, Secretary of the Cabinet? Those that came before us never thought of such an exercise. Maybe you can reflect why things went the way they went. But that's not for them. This workshop is about us. We are here to do what we believe is right for the people of Zambia. I therefore expect all of you ministers going forward to strictly adhere to the laid down procedures, processes and practices that the presenters, I believe so, will share with us, with you today. And I encourage you to be attentive, please. Again, I watch, in the past I was watching, ministers are having a session, and people are sleeping in the session. I don't think anyone has to say more about it. Why would you be sleeping in a meeting? Relax, stand up, just walk about, be attentive. Then you will miss valuable, you know, lessons. Please, just the way we carry ourselves, already Zambians are saying, this is it. Where were these people? But these people is you. You are the mirror of this team, people's team. Experience from the past government shows that the common cause of misunderstandings between ministers and technocrats could be many. But among these is a failure to understand and appreciate one government's vision. This government's vision, in our case, which I believe is very clear, make our manifesto where our vision is clearly spelled out as part of your reading material when you feel bored. Please, that clarity is important. Government's vision. Our government's policies. You have been in the party or associated with this party different periods of time amongst yourselves. But even the older members of the party, please find time to reflect, read, refresh on the party vision, on the party policies, and that may help as you provide leadership in the ministry and guiding the technocrats. But also it's true that the failure to appreciate, I think Secretary of the Cabinet has mentioned, distinct roles and responsibilities between ministers and technocrats or staff could create a problem also. I choose to express myself the way I feel on this one. Actually, it's not a one-sided issue. Sometimes ministers transgress on the roles of technocrats. It is also true that sometimes technocrats transgress on roles of the ministry, on the ministers, and take advantage that ministers are not involved in their responsibilities, and therefore they can do what they want. That's true, Secretary of the Cabinet. This is not your induction, but you are part of Cabinet. You are Cabinet member. In a way, you sit in Cabinet. I beg your pardon. The laws must be followed. You sit in Cabinet. So that too will not work to continue with old habits, because the ministers are not procurement officers. Yes, they are not, but they are supervisors. It takes two to tango. So even the technocrats must understand the UPND vision and objectives, and then the team will work well. Of course, minister is not a permanent secretary. Permanent secretary is not a minister. But I think I've illustrated the point here. It is therefore expected that as policymakers, you will provide the necessary leadership to ensure a productive environment, a working environment, and relationships with your permanent secretaries and other officials in your respective ministries and provinces. And I think I've already made the point that the reverse is also true. A team means the ministers and the technocrats. Simply put, ministers beginning to take up administrative functions to be procurement officers, finance officers. I was chatting with somebody. I said, what should we not do which others before us were doing it? And they singled out one minister. Immediately they moved in the previous, I'm not targeting anybody, in the previous regimes, so I can conceal. Immediately that minister moved in there, they took over procurement functions, they were the accounting officers, finance officers, they were buying, and I'm sure you can have an idea. And you end up in trouble. Then you start blaming others. I wish to mention that in line with the Constitution of Zambia, particularly Article 931, which provides that, and I quote, a decision or instruction of the president shall be in writing under the president's signature. End of quote. On my part, as your colleague, I will abide by this constitutional provision in my giving instructions to you as ministers. Similarly, it follows that your instructions to your permanent secretaries shall also be in writing. Of course, in a meeting you discuss. After that, you can get your permanent secretary to reduce it in writing to avoid misunderstanding, clarity of instructions. But remember, if you reduce anything to writing, you better do your homework. I guess you know what I'm saying. You better do your homework. Is what I'm doing right? Is my instruction legal? But Secretary of Cabinet, I reverse this position. Equally, the technocrats must stay within the law. Equally, the technocrats must take responsibility for decisions they are making. Let me return to the ball. If you're the technocrat, you're the procurement officer, you're the finance officer, why are you paying 60,000 kwacha for a borehole of 20,000 kwacha? You too must better be on the right side of things. This sounds a difficult thing to do. No, that's what we do in our homes, with our children, with our wives. That's what we do. How can a child go to buy bread at a grocery shop for 15 kwacha and they come back and tell you that, Daddy, Mommy, you gave me 20 kwacha, I spent it on bread. But bread is 15 kwacha. She must bring change for 5 kwacha. Charity begins at home. That's how we live normal lives. We're not saying something strange. Honorable ministers, cabinet, provincial ministers, ladies and gentlemen, this induction of ministers is part of the process of enhancing government operations to ensure efficient and effective policy implementation and service delivery, goes without saying. It is therefore expected that after this induction, you will take time to familiarize yourself, very important, with the materials that will be presented to you. After your induction, you will be required to ensure that adequate consultations are made on police matters before public engagement. This will result in factual and coordinated communication as well as positive perception of us by the public. And you are the carriers of that interpretation of perception because you are rubbing shoulders with people every day. And people should be proud of you as a minister. As I conclude, I urge you to take the induction seriously, fully participate, please, in the deliberations, as I said earlier on, after your participation in this induction program, I think we should be able to work harmoniously together, better relationships. It takes time to build friendship relationships, working relationships. It takes time. I come from a professional home myself, and I know how much it has helped me in how to work with people. Polite but fair, driven by common interest. You shall be okay. But it takes time to build relationships that are meaningful. And I believe, we believe you are equal to the task. You are leaders in your own right. You've come a long way to be ministers. You've done a lot. Just search in that bag of history, experience, it will serve you well. I believe that from here on, we will be able to work towards ensuring effective service delivery for the benefit of the people of Zambia. Always, always, please. With these remarks, I have the privilege to declare this induction program for cabinet and provincial ministers officially open. May God bless you all. May God bless our great country, which we intend to make greater together. This our country, Zambia. I thank you all.